Thank you. The final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 10491 in the name of Keith Brown on devolution of employment law. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Keith Brown to open the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Mr Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I rise in support of the motion which calls for the devolution of employment law. This aligns, of course, with the Scottish Government's commitment to a fairer and stronger Scotland, with the right to fair work at its heart. But the motion is important for all of Scotland, especially those areas where the history of industrial action runs deep, like my own constituency of Clackmannanshire and Dunblane. Clackmannanshire holds a significant place in the history of industrial action in Scotland, being one of the focal points of the miners' strikes of the 1970s and 80s. We must never forget those who, in their fight for fairer wages and safer working conditions, all too often found themselves to be the victims of the actions of particularly callous and uncaring UK governments. The memory of the Clackmannanshire strike serves as a stark reminder of the challenges endured by workers before the creation of this Scottish Parliament, and I know that this history will resonate with many of the members in the Chamber and in many communities across Scotland. For too long, it's been the case that successive UK governments have legislated against the right of Scottish workers to take industrial action. Indeed, this motion highlights two pieces of legislation, the Conduct of Employment Agencies and Employment Businesses Amendment Regulations of 2022 and the Strikes Minimum Services Levels Act 2023, both of which pose a significant risk to the rights of workers in Scotland and across the UK. And these regulations represent yet another attempt by the UK government to curtail the right of workers to take industrial action to protect the dignity of their labour. Trade unions are an essential part of our democracy and are absolutely necessary to ensure that the voice of working people is heard. And having served as a trade union representative myself, I'll always speak up for the right of workers to engage in industrial action. Indeed, Scotland's history is filled with examples of successful collective action, such as the UCS Workins, led by the indomitable Jimmy Reid. And these instances continue to stand as a testament to the power of industrial action, not only in Scotland, but across the world. But the creation of the Scottish Parliament has allowed Scotland to right some of the historical wrongs perpetrated on working people by the UK government by implementing measures like pardoning those convicted during the miners' strike. I was very proud to take that legislation through this Parliament and to have relatively unanimous support for that measure. The record of the Scottish Government collaborating with trade unions rather than working against them speaks for itself. The notable absence of any NHS strikes in Scotland over the past year, unlike in other UK nations, should not be dismissed. It is a clear indication that the Scottish Government's approach of actively engaging with trade unions works. I will do.
Does he characterise the relationships between the EIS, between Unison, GMB and other trade unions in schools and in further and higher education in the same way as he's just characterised the relationship in other areas?
Keith Brown.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the very first part of what Pam Duncan-Glassy said there. She mentioned a number of trade unions working together. I'm happy to come back to that if she wants to come back in again, but I didn't hear the first part of what she said. I do think, though, that, as I've said before, that the Scottish Government does work very collaboratively with trade unions. That's been my experience during the periods when I was
in. Mr Brown, could you please resume your seat for a second? Thank you. Mr Mara, please don't do that across the floor. Thank you very much. Mr Brown, please continue.
President, the devolution of employment law, as called for in the motion, would allow us to take this constructive approach even further. It's for this reason an increasing number of trade unions from across the UK now back the devolution of employment law, and I'm very pleased to say that the UK-wide Trade Union Congress recently followed the Scottish Trade Unions Congress in calling for employment law to be devolved to Scotland, as well as calling for the repeal of all anti-trade union legislation, two measures which the Scottish Government supports but does not currently have the power to deliver. Now, given the fact that both the Scottish and UK TUC stand behind the devolution of employment law in their support for workers and for devolution, I'd like to make known my feelings of utter disappointment and dismay at the recent announcement from the Deputy Leader of the UK Labour Party that they have now scrapped the Labour Party's previous commitment to devolving employment law. Yeah. I have with me today a printed copy of Scottish Labour's 2021 manifesto, which the 22 Labour MSPs were elected on. On page 30, it states in no uncertain terms, we support further devolution of powers to Scotland, including borrowing and employment rights. So you can imagine my shock, Presiding Officer, when the Daily Record broke the news last week that an email was sent around all the Labour MSPs advising them not to sign this motion, which may or may not, in fact, be in support of one of their own policies. Why would they not want to support something which absolutely reflects their own policies, unless it's the case they don't mean it at all? It reminded me of a long time ago when I was a councillor in Alloa, and I put a motion up which congratulated Alloa Athletic winning promotion to a higher division. It was opposed by the Labour Party, and I asked them afterwards why, and they said, well, it was the SNP that proposed it. We went back to a future meeting and they agreed it and changed one word to it. It's what became known as the Bain principle. If the SNP proposes it, you cannot accept it. But in this case, they're doing that flying in the face of the rights of employers and the need for better employment law in Scotland. And just days before a crucial by-election in Rutherglen and Hamilton West, the Scottish Labour Party is backpedalling on yet another of its most fundamental principles just to abide by the diktats of Keir Starmer's UK Labour Party. I will take an intervention.
Daniel Johnson.
So Keith Brown's mentioned the TUC motion. Would he also acknowledge that there was a formal reservation lodged that's saying that you need to create a floor across the UK before you devolve employment law? And that is the position that continues to be the position of the Scottish Labour Party. And it's a very important caveat. Would he acknowledge that?
Keith Brown.
I have listened over the last number of years to a number of Labour MSPs stating explicitly they wanted to see employment law devolved to the Scottish Parliament. Yeah. We now have caveats, an unwillingness to support a straightforward motion which would help defend the rights of workers and trade unions in Scotland. I have much time left, but I've given way twice in relation to this. And I'm happy to give so again if you'd say, if there's a compelling reason why you cannot support the terms of the motion that's in front of you, there's nothing that conflicts with Labour policy, if you're going to do that.
Michael Mara.
I am, Presiding Officer. The motion states the immediate devolution, as Mr Johnson has just set out, the position of the Scottish Labour Party is that there has to be a floor created across the UK and then devolution, which is actually the position of the TUC. It's the position of the TUC.
Keith Brown.
I don't know whether he thinks that those from trade unions and workers across Scotland looking at those weasel words will give any credence to the Labour Party's position, any reason not to support it just because it's from the SNP. So, in closing, the motion calls on the UK Government not to further erode the hard-won rights of Scottish workers. Instead, we state that these rights are not just for the benefit of workers, but the betterment of society and our economy. And across the chamber, we can reaffirm this Parliament's commitment to working in partnership with trade unions and to entrench and build on those rights. Our workers deserve nothing less, and it's high time that we took control. This is nothing contentious for the Labour Party. They've stated they wanted to do this for a number of years. We can take control of our own destiny and craft a country where workers' rights are valued, where fairness is the norm, and where the Scottish Parliament works in partnership with trade unions rather than against them to build a fairer, more just and prosperous Scotland. What we're getting from the Labour Party is an indication they will support nothing. If they can't do it in opposition, they will certainly not do it in government. Yeah. I would ask the Parliament to support the motion in my name.
Thank you. I now call Kevin Stewart to be followed by Donald Cameron. Mr Stewart.
Officer, and I welcome the opportunity to discuss this issue today and pay tribute to Mr Brown for bringing this debate to the Chamber. I certainly do not pay tribute to the Labour Party for their stance in this, failing to sign what was a motion which I thought they would be running to sign. And now it seems today that we have heard of a flip-flop from Labour around about the devolution of employment law. Because in this chamber, not so long ago, in an exchange with Pauline McNeill, she said that we would devolve it now. And that's exactly what Mr Brown has called for in his motion. Mm-hmm. There was no word then, and this is the first I've heard it today, about the creation of a floor before employment law could be devolved. I think this is yet another storm or flip-flop that Scottish Labour has decided to kowtow to. They have taken their orders from Keir, don't rock the boat, and we'll deal with this later. And I'll take Mr Mara.
Michael Mara.
I appreciate the member giving way. Doesn't it recognise, lauding the position rightly of the TUC? The TUC have made clear that this caveat, that there has to be an agreement across the UK to create that floor, and we believe that devolution can then further secure those rights for the long term.
Kevin Stewart.
There's been any caveats that I've heard from the STUC, and this is the first time I've heard of this caveat from Labour. No, I've taken your intervention, Mr Mara, and I don't want to hear about your further flip-flopping. Presiding officer, with draconian legislation like the EU retained law bill and the anti-strike bill passed through the UK Parliament earlier this year, it's clear that protecting workers' rights are more important than ever. And Tory crackdowns on worker protections and the rights of unions has seen the UK's global rating on workers' rights fall. Now, what are those global ratings? The UK has dropped in the International Trade Union Confederation's annual report on workers' rights, falling from a rating of 3 countries where the ITUC considers there to be a regular violation of rights, to level 4, where that confederation says that there is systemic violations. That means that the UK joins countries with that level 4 rating, like Qatar, like Saudi Arabia, like Vietnam, despotic regimes where freedoms, as we know, are is not as great as they should be. We are now in the same league as them. And Scotland is already missing out on Europe's enhancement of workers' rights, thanks to Westminster's hard Brexit. This is the same UK government that ensures that the UK sick pay is one of the worst in Europe, and where workers have been subjected to years of neglect by the Tories. And it seems to me, and today confirms my belief, that Labour offers no difference. No difference whatsoever. The only way to protect workers in Scotland is to devolve employment law to this Parliament. Devolution of workers' rights is backed by some of the biggest trade unions in the country and, of course, the STUC. And it is astonishing, Presiding Officer, that not one Labour MSP has agreed with a motion that calls out Westminster's anti-trade union legislation and is again workers' rights. It's time for that devolution to take place. It's time for us to treat our workers much more fairly. It's time for us to rise up those world rankings once again. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Stewart. I now call Donald Cameron to be followed by CoCab Stewart. Mr Cameron.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I begin by saying it is, I think, sadder to take part in another highly politicised members' debate. I don't aim that at any individual because I know all parties have done this in the past. I just think it's regrettable and not in the spirit of this chamber. These debates should be a rare moment to build consensus, and I feel those opportunities are being eroded. But turning to the substance of Keith Brown's motion, I want to make some specific points. The politics of this debate is quite clear. It's about the differences between the SNP and Labour on the limits of devolution with a by-election coming up next week. But I should say I spent much of my professional career as an employment lawyer, and I should refer to my register of interest at this moment as an advocate. But I spent that time in the employment tribunals of Scotland in Aberdeen, in Dundee, Glasgow, and here in Edinburgh, representing both workers, employers, trade unions, acting in cases of dismissal, redundancy, and discrimination. And it's something I know a little about and have seen at the sharp end when disputes sadly end up in litigation. But I did learn one thing above all, and that is the importance of a UK-wide system of employment law and a corresponding UK-wide tribunal structure to support and police it. And what's been lost in this debate so far and needs restating today is the rationale behind why employment law has not been devolved and why these benches support the status quo. And the reason for that is essentially economic. Yes.
Keith Brown.
I just would ask whether Donald Cameron is aware that the one part of employment law which has been devolved or has been agreed to be devolved under the Smith Convention is actually employment tribunals in many forms. Is he aware of that?
Donald Cameron.
I am aware of that, and I'm aware of the upgrade to the employment system, the tribunals, the upper tribunal, the lower tribunal, that's happened in the last 10 years. But returning to the point I was making, the reason for this is essentially an economic one. It's clear that two separate systems of employment law between Scotland and England would create a headache for both workers and businesses that operate on a cross-border basis, particularly small and medium-sized business. You could have, for instance, two different contracts of employment for those working between Scotland and England, businesses having to monitor different sets of laws, employees having to adhere to different systems of regulation. And that leads to cost and logistical difficulties and complexity for both workers and businesses, and the suppression of the free flow of labour between Scotland and England. And just as we need a UK-wide approach to the goods and services market, so too do we need a UK-wide approach to employment. And as I think the former UK Minister for Labour Markets, Jane Hunt, said, ONS data estimates that around 68,000 people work in Scotland and live in England, or vice versa, and devolving employment rights could be highly disruptive for workers who work across the border. So, Deputy Presiding Officer, creating that divergence from an existing UK-wide employment law would have significant ramifications. And stating those points doesn't mean that the rights of workers are somehow diminished by maintaining the status quo. You can still support fair work. You can still support the right to strike. You can still support equality rights. You can still pass legislation such as the pardoning of striking miners. You can still respect and support all of Scotland's workers. You can still ensure that when any dispute arises over pay and conditions, government engages with workers and their representatives to ensure a fair deal is struck. So, Deputy Presiding Officer, these benches support the rights of all Scotland's workers, and we want to continue to see a UK-wide approach to the labour market. We want to ensure there can continue to be that free flow of labour. And unlike others in this chamber, we will always work with business and employees to achieve this rather than work against them. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Cameron. I now call Cocab Stewart to be followed by Daniel Johnson. Cocab Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Keith Brown for bringing this debate to the Chamber. I think it's fair to say that the situation faced by workers up and down the UK today is quite bleak. For most people, wages increases are struggling to make up for the massive decrease in the value of money in their bank accounts, and the role of trade unions, the role that they can play, is under attack. Meanwhile, practices such as unpaid work trials and exploitative zero-hours contracts remain the norm in some sectors. Now, 13 years of Tory policymaking has certainly made a difference, and I don't think that there would be any that would claim that it would be for the better. Where the situation remains bleak is with the Labour Party. If Keir Starmer really is Prime Minister in waiting, what difference would it make? The past few months have revealed Labour's hand, that they are engaged in a race to the bottom on issues such as immigration, welfare and Brexit. I'll take that intervention.
Daniel Johnson.
Is she aware that we have promised to legislate within 100 days on a new deal for working people, which would transform, not my words, but the TUC General Secretary's workers' rights up and down the UK? Is she aware of that?
Cocab Stewart.
I am aware that Labour makes many policy suggestions which they then go on to flip-flop and U-turn on a regular basis. There remains no suggestion that Labour would hold true to any promises that they make in improving the lives and conditions of workers across the UK. However, the question over whether Scotland should have the ability to take different decisions when it comes to employment is what we're discussing today. And I would like to bring the Chamber's focus onto one specific area that I take a deep interest in, the ability of asylum seekers to work while they are applying to remain in the UK. This cuts across two areas that are reserved, employment as well as immigration. Flatly speaking, asylum seekers are not allowed to work in the UK while their application is being processed. As members are likely aware, this process is a long one. Most applications take more than 6 months. There are very limited circumstances where Home Office says asylum seekers can seek employment. If a person has been waiting for more than 12 months for a decision, for instance, and the Home Office deems that the delay is not the applicant's fault, they can seek employment, but only from the UK government's restrictive shortage occupation list. That said, the Home Office will not provide data on the number of asylum seekers granted permission to work, so there is no way for us to scrutinise that. So a system that makes no sense. The financial support given to asylum seekers by the UK government is extremely low, less than £50 a week. If they were able to work, they would be able to pay taxes. It would be easy to conclude, therefore, that the reason the system exists, that it must be down to ideology and not pragmatism. And to be clear here, it was Labour who restricted asylum seekers being able to apply for work in 2002. The ability to apply after 12 months was then introduced in 2005, but it was only done in order to comply with EU law. And the Conservatives and the Liberal Democrats further restricted what work asylum seekers could do by limiting it to shortage occupation list in 2010. UK governments of every hue have let down asylum seekers and the communities that they're residing in. These are people from a range of backgrounds and professions, and they want to be able to contribute. Their inability to do so is to our detriment as much as it is to theirs. And sadly, we live in a UK system that imposes a hostile environment on those who come here. A hostile environment that was actually introduced by the Labour government under Tony Blair in 2007 and then continued and enhanced by the Conservatives. Asylum seekers just want to provide for their families. They just want a bit of dignity as they navigate an often demoralising and elongated application system. They deserve to do that, presiding officer, safe in the knowledge that they will be treated equally and in compliance with fair work principles. In closing, presiding officer, the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee, which I convene, has recently concluded an inquiry into the lived experience of asylum seekers in Scotland. The report will be published soon and it would be inappropriate for me to speculate on its contents. However, I hope that the committee's work on this will help to inform government policy on asylum seekers and their ability to integrate and contribute. The current system provides a perpetual stream of missed opportunities. I have no doubt that an independent Scotland would make better choices on employment and how we treat workers, how we treat those who come here. Short of independence, the UK should devolve to Scotland our ability to make policy in those areas.
You are quite over your time. We've got a number of speakers in debate. Thank you very much indeed. I call Daniel Johnson to be followed by Ben McPherson. Mr.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Let me begin with where we absolutely unequivocally agree. I agree that we strengthen the economy by improving workers' rights, and that is exactly what a Labour government would seek to do for the whole of the UK, not just for parts of the UK. Labour's New Deal for Working People, which is a commitment to legislate within 100 days, would do the following things. It would ban compulsory zero-hours contracts. It would outlaw fire and rehire. It would give workers day-one rights on sick pay, parental leave, protection from unfair dismissal. It would provide workers' status for people regardless of the type of employment, tackling directly the many issues that people face when they're working in the so-called gig economy. But perhaps most importantly, what we would do is to raise the minimum wage so it was a real living wage. And that is exactly why Paul Novak, the TUC General Secretary, said that the New Deal for Working People represents the biggest upgrade in workers' rights in a decade. And that's a direct quote. The reality is that... Very happy to.
Maggie Chapman.
I thank the member for taking an intervention. Does he accept that workers in Scotland could have had all of that 9 years ago?
Daniel Johnson.
Let me be very clear that what we need to do is ensure that we have high standards for all workers throughout the UK. What we don't want to do is create a situation where there is a race to the bottom, which is precisely why when we have made our... Just in a moment, Mr McKee. When we have made our calls for devolution of employment law, it has been very clear that as within a regime that creates a floor, a minimum set of standards, that is what we have said in both in 2019 and the 2021. What is more, and I'm sorry that Mr Brown thinks these are weasel words, but to quote Liz Foyer from the STUC, which she said that a guaranteed minimum floor of workers' rights across the UK is a prudent first step towards achieving devolution of employment law. Her words, not mine, issued in September and a direct result of that TUC motion. Very happy to give way to
Ivan McKee.
Thanks to Daniel Johnson for taking intervention. Does Daniel Johnson think that having higher standards, higher employment rights in Scotland makes it more or less likely that standards will increase across the rest of the UK?
Daniel Johnson.
What is important is that we have guaranteed minimum standards across UK. If you had an open framework, which is what would be created with an immediate devolution, you create a scenario, a situation where you invite a race to the bottom, which is absolutely not in anyone's interest, certainly not in workers' interest. And let's be clear, every time Labour has been in government, we have made a difference to workers' rights, whether that's protection from unfair dismissal, health and safety at work, equal pay legislation, minimum wage, the Equalities Act. Every single Labour government, every time, making change, and not just change, change that no government has been able to reverse. No government has dared to unpick them. That is the difference that a Labour government has made in the past. It's a difference that a Labour government will make again. And frankly, and in closing, just to, I think, reflect something that Donald Cameron said, it is something of a sorry sight to see the SNP deputy leader reduced to using a members' debate to making such naked party political attacks. But what is also clear is a sign of the SNP desperation, scared of what an improved and strengthening Labour Party represents, because they prefer the status quo. They prefer having a Tory government. So rather than fighting a Tory government, they prefer to attack Labour. Because rather than delivering, they prefer the politics of division. But we are here to deliver. We are here to deliver for the whole of the UK, rather than creating division, which is all the SNP are ultimately interested in. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Johnson. I now call Ben McPherson to be followed by Michael Mara. Ms McPherson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I think back to the Leith Docker strike in 1913, and when those campaigners and individuals and trade unionists took to the streets of Leith and pushed for better conditions for their workers. They lived in a time of deep income inequality, as we do now. And I wanted to speak today on behalf of my constituents, too many of whom are living in work poverty. We committed as a parliament several years ago in 2017 to addressing child poverty. 21% of working age adults living in poverty are doing so after housing costs. And in that group, there are 69% of children living in poverty are in working households. That's the figures from 2019 to 22. And that's, of course, in a situation where 24% of children are living in relative poverty after housing costs. And that's something that should concern all of us, because while this Parliament and our devolved government has the capacity to make changes in terms of public sector wage differentials, and of course it has done, and that's why it's successfully avoided strike action in a number of areas and provided a situation where workers here in Scotland in the public sector are better paid than elsewhere in the UK, and that makes an impact on reducing poverty. For the 4/5 of the working population in the private sector, the Scottish Government can do a lot in terms of persuasion and pushing employers to do the right thing, and the drive towards the real living wage has made an important difference. But it's binding in the law a real living wage that makes sure that private employers pay enough.
And this is the problem with the situation we have here in Scotland, in that so many of my constituents who come to me in real difficulty are in households where there is working-age adults and they're working in the private sector. So we're absolutely right to push as a parliament for these powers over Fair Work in particular to come to this parliament. Because whatever your thoughts on the final destination in terms of Scotland's constitution and this institution, it is clear that if this parliament is to protect our people from decisions elsewhere in the UK that have a negative impact in Scotland and are against the social democratic governance that Scotland consistently has voted for throughout my lifetime, then employment powers, along with, I would argue, more financial powers and more social security powers, need to come to this parliament to deliver social justice. It's not enough for Labour Party colleagues to say, if and when we get a UK Labour government, they'll be able to do X, Y, Z. What about the years in between? What about the years in between where all of our constituents suffer from a lack of good working conditions and fair pay? That's not acceptable to me, and it shouldn't be acceptable to all of us on the centre left. So we need employment powers to come to this parliament. Yes, there will need to be careful considerations about cross-border issues, and any Scottish government with the powers over employment law will need to be thoughtful and responsible in how it exercises them. But it's absolutely right that the control over employment law should come to this Scottish parliament, and any UK government should be forthcoming in bringing a Scotland Act in the next UK Parliament that delivers that. It's the right thing for social justice. It's the right thing for making sure that this Parliament has the suite of powers to protect our constituents who too often and in too many numbers have been living in work poverty. It's not right and it needs to change.
Thank you, Mr McPherson. I now call Michael Mara to be followed by Maggie Chapman. Mr Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Keith Brown, MSP, for affording Parliament the chance to this debate on enhancing workers' rights. I refer members to my register of interest as a member of both Community of the Union and the GMB as a lifelong trade unionist. Because there are two principal means by which the lives of ordinary Scots have been improved since the start of the 20th century. And the first of these is organised trade unionism, based on collective solidarity and the struggle for our fundamental human right to withhold our labour. The second of these is Labour governments, committed to a more equal country, investing in public services, in the public protection through the law, and crucially, in enhancing trade union rights. The next Labour government will introduce legislation on a new deal for working people within its first 100 days in office. And the General Secretary of the TUC, as cited by Mr Brown, has described Labour's plans as transformative, and I quote, the biggest upgrade in workers' rights in a generation. Please.
Keith Brown.
Can I thank Michael Mara for taking intervention and maybe mention, of course, the £4 billion pillaging of the Miners' Pension Fund, the fact there was no pardons given to miners and there was no end to blacklisting under the last Labour government. But crucially, in 2015, 17, 19, we're told these things can wait, must wait until we be a Labour government elected. Is it the case, if Labour does not win the election, that Scottish workers are going to have to continue to wait and be deprived of the enhanced rights possible to them if we don't devolve employment law?
Michael Mara.
I entirely agree with Mr Brown's call to defeat this Tory government and get them out. There's one way to do that, I would say. There's one way to deliver it. I'm also not really entirely sure that I follow the member's logic, Presiding Officer, as to how he might see these powers being devolved, given the position of the Conservative Party. The best way for the SNP to act as deputy leader, perhaps Mr Brown can take some of that, is to act in concert and cooperation with the Labour Party to deliver these powers to Scotland once we establish that floor across the UK. Because Labour's New Deal for Working People will repeal the 2016 Trade Union Act, yeah. It will repeal the Minimum Services yeah. Bill, it will repeal strike-breaking yeah. legislations, it will overhaul the laws that have restricted the fair operation of trade unions for working people in the UK, will ban zero-hour contracts, will outlaw fire and rehire, will guarantee day one rights to sick pay, parental leave and protection from unfair dismissal, and we will ensure the minimum wage is a livable wage. So when was the last transformative upgrade in workers' rights a generation ago to which the General Secretary of the TUC refers. It was, of course, the Labour government elected in 1997, which started by guaranteeing the legal right to join a trade union, service rights, holiday rights, paternity rights. Yeah. It moved to outlaw much of blacklisting across the UK. It introduced a minimum wage for the first time in the history of these nations. And of course, this isn't just history, Presiding Officer. All of these rights are measures which improve the lives of Scots today, every single day. Yeah. And it's this record that we stand on that tells us the New Deal for working people will be delivered by a Labour government. And once that new common basis for rights has been placed, Scottish Labour will seek to secure it against future Tory attacks through the devolution of employment law with the maintenance of that UK-wide floor so it cannot be removed. And devolution acting as a protection of progress to ensure that there's no race to the bottom on employment rights as seen by so many in countries across the world. But I would say, I've closed, Presiding Officer, talking about the conspicuous absence from Mr Brown's motion of zero-hour contracts today. Scotland has the highest rate of zero-hour contracts among people of employment of any part of the UK. Any part of the UK. And worse still, in SNP Scotland, a zero-hours contract is actually counted as a positive destination for school leavers. They could do something about that today. So on what planet is insecure, precarious work a positive destination? Only last week, it was reported the SNP were using workers on zero-hours contracts to distribute leaflets in Rutherglen and Hamilton West for the by-election. They don't even have a zero-tolerance policy in their own party, let alone the country. So while the SNP will equivocate and prevaricate, Labour is clear we will end that scourge and we will deliver on our New Deal for working people.
Thank you, Mr Mara. I now call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Monica Lennon. Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Keith Brown for securing this important debate. This is an issue I have taken a keen interest in for many years. I'm an active trade unionist, and I refer colleagues to my register of interests. I'm a member of Unite the Union. Back in 2014, devolution of employment legislation was something that featured regularly in debates and discussions about the kind of future Scotland's people wanted to see. I and many others argued that, whilst we didn't necessarily need independence to progress workers' rights, to improve their conditions and secure better democracy in our workplaces, it would certainly make those things easier. 13 years of a UK Labour government had not overturned the anti-trade union legislation in its entirety that Thatcher brought in decades before. And we certainly weren't going to get progress under successive Tory governments. But I digress. The Smith Commission conversations were interesting. I learned a lot about a range of things in those concentrated, sometimes heated, meetings. I learned how different people did politics. I learned about political negotiation. I learned about tribalism. I learned about the intransigence that tribalism breeds. And I learned about the lowest common denominator politics that, it seemed, the Labour representatives on that commission were willing to promote. When we, Greens, and the SNP members of that commission proposed the devolution of employment law, the Labour representatives simply said no. There were no arguments made about solidarity across borders, although those had been made before the referendum vote itself. It was just no. No discussion, no nothing. It was almost as if it was no as punishment. Punishment of Scotland for daring to suggest that we could do better. Punishment of all of us who dared to imagine a better world. Punishment of hope. And as time has moved on, it really does seem like it was punishment of hope. Despite calls from the trade union movement and others on the left for something better, aligning with a Conservative government, putting the fate of our workers in the hands of a Conservative government, seemed to be more appealing than working to create something better. Because we know that there is no intrinsic reason why employment law could not be devolved. It might be complicated, yes, but as Northern Ireland shows, it is possible. There is considerable divergence between Northern Ireland and Great Britain. Regressive changes in Great Britain are not mirrored in the north of Ireland, and this might be of interest to those who have been going on about a UK-wide system. It doesn't exist at the moment. If Labour had not vetoed the devolution of employment law by collaborating with the Tories, we could now have a real living wage, a total ban on zero-hours contracts, on fire and rehire, as well as the reinstatement of employment and trade union rights removed by the Tories. Those powers would make our efforts to bring children out of poverty or to ensure a just transition to communities that are sustainable in every sense so much easier. Stronger trade unions could be at the forefront of creating cohesive, cooperative societies, of standing up against exploitation. The vague possibilities that a new Labour government in London might repeal the worst of Tory anti-worker legislation is not a good enough reason to oppose the devolution of these powers now. And it certainly is not
the member is probably bringing her remarks to close.
I am. It is certainly not a good enough prospect for our workers and communities now. Because let's remember that we are governed by a Tory government whose employment regulations last year were quashed by a court who found the Secretary of State's failure to carry out mandatory consultation to be, and I quote, so unfair as to be unlawful and indeed irrational. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, our workers and our communities are paying a heavy price for the tribal, lowest common denominator politics that sought 9 years ago to punish hope. I wish we had instead the option of building on that hope. That day cannot come soon enough.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. Before I call the next speaker, I would advise members that due to the number of members who would wish to speak in this debate, I am minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes. I now invite Keith Brown to move a motion without notice.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that the debate be extended by up to 30 minutes. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That is agreed. I now call Monica Lennon to be followed by Ivan McKee. Ms. Lennon.
I'll start by referring to my register of interest as a member of Unite, the GMB, a member of the RMT Parliamentary Group, and a convener of the Scottish Labour Trade Union Group. I'd like to thank Keith Brown for bringing this debate to the Chamber, and it is good to see so many members taking an interest, because what we can agree on is that anti-trade union legislation is harmful to members in Keith Brown's constituency, in Central Scotland, my region, and to workers right across the UK. And points have been made about the scourge of in-work poverty too. So I believe that most people in the Chamber care about these issues. The Labour movement, of course, believes in more protection for workers, and that's what informed my political thinking. I grew up as a girl in Blantyre in Lanarkshire, the daughter of a health and safety officer, shaped by what was happening to working class communities like mine. So the well-being of workers has shaped my early political thinking. And today, that matters more than ever. We've heard from members across the chamber about the epidemic of fire and rehire, 0 hours contracts, precarious work, people in my neighbourhood who are working three jobs and often more just to make ends meet. And I was listening carefully to Keith Brown, who spoke passionately about the industrial history of his area of Clackmannanshire and Dunblane and his important work in pardoning the miners. And that did bring people together across the chamber. Neil Findlay and Richard Leonard on our benches, Mr Brown and Michael Matheson to name but a few for the SNP. And I think what's probably uncomfortable about this debate for some people is it actually there is more agreement than many of us probably want to admit. So I see a majority in this parliament to repeal the anti-trade union law that we know is letting people down. It maybe is sticking in the throat of some to recognise that what Labour is trying to do at a UK level with the New Deal for working people, it is about being transformative, it is about being progressive. And yes, of course, we're not at the election yet, we don't know what the outcome will be, but let's focus on the things that we do actually agree on, because Scottish Labour has been very clear, and as Starwar has said, it's about a race to the top, it's not about a race to the bottom. Yes.
Keith Brown.
Can I thank Monica Lennon for taking intervention and acknowledge the sincerity with which she speaks on these issues, as she's done in the past. In fact, she was very explicit in 2021 saying Scottish Labour is supportive of the devolution of employment law. So we do agree but the terms of my motion were explicitly put together so we could actually crystallise that. There's nothing in my motion which should dissuade Monica Lennon, who's got a proud track record in relation to this, from supporting the motion. Can I ask why it is that she hasn't supported the motion? And does she believe that Scottish workers in Scotland should always wait on something happening elsewhere before they can get access to full employment rights?
Monica Lennon.
I can get, but I think it's a very important question. I'm speaking in the debate because I care deeply about these issues. I haven't signed a motion, but I actually haven't signed an amendment either, because what I wanted to do was stand aside from some of the politicking that's going on. I think it's a very good motion from Mr Brown. At the very end, I've underlined the word immediately because I'm not sure what that means. There isn't a big button we can press today to devolve, you know, employment law immediately. But of course, the Scottish Labour manifesto from 2021, which we stood on, sets out a clear position. That's been reinforced by the Scottish leader, Anas Sarwar, and there, you know, isn't a bit of paper between what we're saying in terms of the STUC and the TUC, who represent 5.5 million workers across the UK. There is a lot of agreement there. What I would say, and I know I've now probably eaten into a lot of my own time, but yes, to Kevin Stewart, let's rise up the world rankings. But you've heard that in terms of 0 hours, Scotland is the 0 hour capital of the UK. So let's do something about that. I started today, presiding officer, at a picket line at Royal Mile Primary School. Tomorrow, I'll be at a picket line in Hamilton near where I live with Unison workers. We've got, as Pam Duncan-Glanty was alluding to, people working in higher education and further education who hear about Fair Work. They don't feel that it's happening for them. We've had people at City of Glasgow College made redundant under the guise of Fair Work. So let's work together to get a just transition. Let's get justice for all workers. We can have these debates in and around by-elections to make points, but actually I think it backfires on all of us. So I will continue to find common agreement, common cause, because workers right now, they don't actually need debates like this. They need money in their bank accounts.
Ms Lennon, please conclude.
So I will thank Keith Brown, and I think if we can have these debates more often, great. But let's not do it as a stunt. Let's do it because we actually believe in progressive
politics.
Thank
you, Ms Lennon. Point of order, Daniel Johnson.
Many apologies, Deputy Presiding Officer. I neglected to refer the Chamber to my register of interest, and I'm a member of the trade unions, both Community and USDOC. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Johnson. Point of order, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Sir, thank you, Presiding Officer. I too neglected to refer to my register of interest. I'm a member of Community, GMB and Unison Unions.
Thank you, Ms Duncan-Glancy. Both points will now be on the record. I call Ivan McKee to be followed by Katie Clark. Mr McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to start by thanking Keith Brown for bringing this very important motion for debate this evening and really highlighting the key issues, not just about the importance of workers' rights and fair pay and fair work that we mostly agree on around the Chamber, but on the very important aspects around devolution and drawing some lines between those who believe that Scotland should have the right to legislate in this area and protect and enhance the rights of Scottish workers and those who clearly don't. Because I want to start by addressing the Labour position. It's been described as flip-flopping, which it absolutely is, to present this as a position where we allegedly need a floor across the rest of the UK is misguided in a number of ways. First of all, the point that I asked... Oh, let me finish the point. The point that I asked Daniel Johnson, in reality, if we have the ability to raise standards in Scotland, how does that constitute a race to the bottom? As Monica Lennon very rightly said, it actually constitutes a race to the top. It allows Scotland to set the standard for the rest of the UK to follow. That should be something that Scottish Labour should welcome. So what we've seen is a positioning here that puts the desire, as Keith Brown said, for Labour to have a go at the SNP's position, to differentiate themselves in some way from the SNP ahead of both their concern for workers' rights in Scotland and their concern in support of the devolution settlement. I give way to Mike O'Mara.
Mike O'Mara.
I appreciate the member giving way. Does he not recognise that both the TUC and the STUC have said that this is the right approach, that we should make sure that there is a common floor across the UK, and then we can devolve it to make sure that we lock those in for the long term?
Ivan McKee.
The reality is that if Scotland has the ability to raise these standards, that will drag the rest of the UK upwards, not the opposite. That's the important point to recognise. It's absolutely clear for anyone to see. And so it shows up not just the inability of Labour to grasp and support these ideas, but frankly, their inability to grasp basic economic principles as well. I'm going to focus in the brief time I have. There's many aspects of this that are very important, but focus on the minimum wage and the ability that we should have within Scotland to be able to address and legislate for that. It's hugely important to tackling poverty, to create those good jobs. It's hugely central to the vision of the wellbeing economy with fair work at its heart. We have seen a gradual reduction in the percentage of people earning less than the real living wage in Scotland, but that's been hard work. It's been had to be done by all kinds of pulling all kinds of other unrelated levers and try to have a secondary impact on that through conditionality and other aspects that have been deployed to help deliver. That's an inefficient way to do it. It's not the most effective way to do it. So legislating to allow the Scottish Parliament, this Parliament, to make the decisions on setting that floor in Scotland on minimum wage, to raise it to at least the level of the real living wage, is absolutely essential to help us raise standards, worker standards, and absolutely central to tackling that poverty challenge that we have, because social security measures and other measures won't on their own deliver what needs to happen to make sure that we lift people in Scotland out of poverty. Briefly, yeah.
Very briefly, please, Ms. Lennon.
I mean, I understand why political parties would critique the words and promises of other political parties. I think there's an important issue here about the zero-hour contracts, because we can do more in Scotland right now. I'm looking at a quote from Neil Gray, the Wellbeing Economy Secretary, who on the 15th of August of this year said, "The Scottish Government firmly opposes the inappropriate use of zero-hour contracts." Don't we need more clarity around the position in Scotland?
Thank you.
I think
they've posed the question to Mr McKee. I think Mr McKee's got the question, and Mr McKee can now respond to you.
The Cabinet Secretary, Neil Gray, has been very clear. We oppose the inappropriate use of zero-hour contracts. So moving on briefly to finish up, this is part of our vision for Scotland's economy, that wellbeing economy, using those levers to drive up wages, using those levers to increase standards, that high-wage, high-technology, innovation economy that's good not just for workers in Scotland, not just for tackling poverty in Scotland, but also, frankly, for Scotland's economy and Scotland's businesses. That's why the motion that Keith Brown has brought here this evening is so hugely important, and that's why everybody in this chamber should be supporting it.
Thank you, Mr McKee. I now call Katie Clark to be followed by Marie McNair. Ms Clark.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I refer to my entry in the Register of Members' Interest relating to my involvement in the trade union movement. And I congratulate Keith Brown on securing this debate and welcome the opportunity to discuss the devolution of employment law powers. It may be that Keith Brown wishes to devolve employment law as a matter of principle. For many, this will be a strategic issue as to whether devolution of employment law is likely to lead to stronger rights for workers. We know that many of the employment protections which were created in the UK, such as equal pay protections, TUPE regulations and discrimination law, were derived from European legislation, the social chapter and a membership of the European Union, which embedded and entrenched those rights in domestic law. So I welcome the mention in his motion as to how we embed, entrench and build on rights and how we do this in a Scottish context. Both Daniel Johnson and Michael Marra spoke about Labour's New Deal for Working People and the transformational potential it has to strengthen rights at work and make work pay. And as Michael Marra says, there is a commitment that a UK Labour government will repeal the anti-trade union and anti-worker legislation, introduce legislation to ban 0 hours contracts, outlaw fire and rehire, strengthen sick pay and parental leave rights, create unfair dismissal rights from day one of employment, and introduce a living wage as a national minimum wage within the first 100 days of government. I think all that are currently in this chamber would agree that this would represent a fundamental shift in power to working people and positively impact on the lives of millions of people across the UK.
Scottish Labour has supported the devolution of employment rights and a UK-wide floor that cannot be removed. We support the UK New Deal for working people and also recognise that it's very unlikely that the current UK Tory government will devolve any aspect of employment law, and I think the speech that we have heard from Donald Cameron today confirms that. So I think there is a very important debate about the devolution of employment law and what rights could make a difference. There's already a discussion about sectoral collective bargaining in relation to the creation of the National Care Service, and that could be extended to other services and sectors. Keith Brown, I think quite rightly, pointed to the pardon for minors as a good example of how this Parliament can make a difference. I understand, with effect from 1st July, the Cabinet Secretary made it a requirement that all organisations seeking public sector grants pay the living wage. And I believe that's already having an impact. And we need this Parliament to be kept updated on the impact of such measures. Because we have to recognise that, for example, despite the fact that effectively the Scottish Government banned zero-hours contracts 5 years ago, for example, recently it was brought to light that there are zero-hours contracts operating in the courts and tribunal services. I suspect no politician was aware of that, but I think it shows the role of this Parliament to be vigilant. We know that employment law and equality law are highly technical, and therefore, in some ways, I do regret the political knockabout involved in this debate, because I do think it's a very important discussion that we need to have in all the political parties, because this is a debate about the devolution of employment law. It's not a debate about independence, and we need to make sure that we find ways to get the strongest possible employment protections for workers in Scotland, ideally across the UK, but we also find mechanisms to embed them so they cannot be taken away. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Clark. I now call Marie McNair to be followed by Mercedes Viaba. Ms McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In contributing to this debate, I bring members' attention to my register of interests as a member of the trade union Unison. I congratulate Keith Brown for securing this debate and acknowledge his long-standing commitment to workers' rights and fair employment policy. The devolution of employment law would give this Parliament the ability to protect workers' rights, increase the living wage, end age discrimination of the statutory living wage, give us the powers to act on companies using fire and rehire policies, tackle the gender pay gap, support parental leave, better trade union recognition policies, and so much more. The Tories' anti-trade union policies, never repealed by the Labour Party, have undermined workers' rights and allowed for an employment landscape where the needs of workers can be placed last. The Trade Union Act 2016 and Brexit legislation show that they only care about continuing in the same direction. Scotland needs a different path that will be helped by the full devolution of employment law. The Labour Party arrogantly claim to be the party of trade union, but then turn up here showing that they don't care about the opinions of trade unions who are clear that they want employment law devolved. Ros Foyer of the STC is clear that devolution gives, and I quote, the chance to draw a line in the sand and ensure no worker in Scotland should ever be subject to any pernicious attack again from a Tory government hell-bent on undermining working people. But despite the views of all trade unions and the TUC and the Labour Party, they've dropped the ball. Another screeching U-turn in policy. The campaign for socialism that some of the lapsed Corbynistas purport to be members of said this. This move puts the Scottish PLP at odds with the STC, the TUC and Scottish Labour members. MSPs must pick a side and abide by their manifesto commitment. Well, we can see that what side they have picked, really, because effectively, clearly, memberships have been lapsed. So instead, we are expected to put our trust in Westminster Labour to deliver, even though their record on keeping promises is a shoddy one. The party who now back Brexit and the rape clause cannot be trusted on workers' rights. Professor Keith Ewing of King's College London has pointed out that an omission to commit to single status of a worker from Keir Starmer recently, and I quote, would render completely pointless the commitments relating to zero-hour contracts, fire and rehire, and flexible working arrangements. On the issue of fire and rehire, Labour have questionable principles there. When it comes to their own staff, the Independent newspaper alleged Labour use fire and rehire, with one senior MP quoted as saying, to learn that our party are now using fire and rehire tactics appalls me. It's everything we as a party should be aggressively opposing. Sacking individuals and hiring others on worse wages and terms and conditions are the actions of the very worst employers. When asked to rebut this, a Labour Party spokesman said, we don't comment on staffing. We also know about their shameful record in equal pay. So we won't trust Labour on workers' rights. Instead, I stand with the trade unions and call for the full devolution of employment law to give this Parliament the
powers members should be concluding very soon,
to provide fair work, decent pay and conditions. And, presiding officer, let's have the ambition to go further to support workers with independent powers over health and safety. Law means that we can do much more to keep our workplaces safe. Power over social security policies means we can do much more to support low-paid workers. Crumbs off the table isn't for us from Westminster. It's not enough for Scottish workers, and a better path is an independent Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McNair. I now call Mercedes Viaba, who will be the last speaker in the open debate, before I ask the Minister to respond. Ms Viaba.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I refer members to my register of interest as a proud trade unionist. I requested to speak in tonight's debate for three reasons. Firstly, because I support the devolution of employment law to Scotland. Secondly, because Scotland's Trade Union Congress supports the devolution of employment law to Scotland. And thirdly, because my party, the Scottish Labour Party, supports the devolution of employment law to Scotland. Presiding Officer, unlike the member and his party, I do not believe in Scottish exceptionalism. I believe in the common endeavour of the people who, united in purpose, can remake our economic system to work in all our favour. So my support for the devolution of employment law stems from my principles of democratic socialism, that power should be held as close to the people as possible, that power should be used in the interest of the people, and that power should be accountable to the people that it serves. So, like the member, I welcome the Trade Union Congress's backing of a motion calling for the devolution of employment law to Scotland, as well as a repeal of all current anti-trade union legislation. Because this call comes from workers themselves. But that's not all workers are calling for. And that's why the next Labour government has committed to a new deal for workers. No more 0 hours contracts. No more fire and rehire. Employment rights from day one. Union rights to access the workplace. New fair pay agreements. Repealing the attack on the right to strike. And where is the SNP's new deal for workers? And what are the SNP offering workers other than zero-hour contracts? So Keith Brown will not be surprised to hear that the General Secretary of the Trade Union Congress has called Labour's new deal for working people, quote, the biggest expansion of workers' rights in a generation. And that's not all he said. He also said, and I quote, that will be the choice at the next election. We want that first 100 days employment bill through in one piece onto the statute books and into the workplaces. And that's why, when the time comes, I will tell anyone who asks, vote for working people. Vote for change. Vote for the party we named for our movement. Vote Labour.
Thank you, Ms. Wiaba. I now call on Minister Richard Lochhead to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Can I begin by saying I'm very grateful to Keith Brown for proposing this debate and bringing this very important matter before Parliament. And there have been many heartfelt contributions from across most of the chamber. And, of course, many, many speakers have participated, which I think shows the importance that members attach to workers' rights in Scotland and the debate around who exercises legislation in relation to those rights, the UK Government or this Scottish Parliament. Now, the Scottish Government's vision is for an economy, of course, it's a fairer economy, a more sustainable economy and a growing economy, but also a country that's offering a decent future for all workers, their families and communities, underpinned by a strong labour market. And for workers, that does mean better job quality, better pay, economic security, a better work-life balance, and that they should have an effective voice, opportunity, security, fulfilment and respect. Now, of course, as we've been debating today, employment rights and duties are a matter reserved to the UK Government under the Scotland Act, and the Scottish Parliament has no say over the minimum wage for workers in Scotland, nor their rights and protections, or over the conduct of industrial relations. It can't legislate to shape a labour market that meets the interests of workers and employers alike to respond to the current and future needs of our economy. And this is despite the enduring support shown by the SDUC, as mentioned by many members and others, particularly during the formative years of the campaign for a Scottish Parliament in the last few decades and the Constitutional Convention and so on. Nevertheless, through fair work, the Scottish Government is doing what it can within devolved competence to drive forward change. And as a result of the action we have taken, there are proportionally five times as many accredited real living wage employers in Scotland as the rest of the UK, and 91% of workers in Scotland earn at least the real living wage. Just to give a couple of examples of what we're doing, given the challenges from the Labour benches who don't seem to be aware of the progress this Parliament has made. We've also had Fair Work First criteria that's been applied to over £4 billion in public funding since 2019.
Monica Lennon.
I'm very grateful to the Minister. In terms of examples, I wonder what can the Scottish Government do to hear the cries of the workers at City of Glasgow College who are emailing MSPs tonight to tell us about cuts to teaching time, increase in workloads, ending of fixed-term contracts, targeted voluntary severance and compulsory redundancies. Is that Fair Work, Minister?
Minister.
Can I say to the member that to deliver good workers' rights in this country, we need employment law devolved? And to escape some of the really tough times this country has experienced just now, we also need the economic levers devolved to this Parliament so we can create a prosperous Scotland and address some of these fundamental issues that are affecting our society at the moment, because we don't have the powers to address them properly, which we would do if this Parliament was independent or had more powers, in the case of today's debate, devolved to us through devolution. Now, our distinct approach, unlike that of the UK Government, is based on partnership working, as demonstrated through the establishment of the Fair Work Convention and our endorsement of the Fair Work Framework. And trade unions are key to this partnership, and a progressive approach to industrial relations is at the very heart of a fair, successful economy. Now, Keith Brown spoke, of course, about the history of strikes in Clackmanningshire, and Scotland has, of course, played a prominent international role in the evolution of the trade union movement and promoting and defending workers' rights. In 1787, the Carlton Weavers' fight for better wages and conditions was Scotland's first major industrial dispute. That was 50 years before the Tallpuddle Martyrs in England, who were sentenced to transportation for forming a union. And, of course, in more recent times, again, as referred to by Keith Brown, the Upper Clyde shipbuilders, led by Jimmy Reid and Jimmy Early, captured the attention and imagination of people around the world. However, recent UK government labour market policies have pushed in the opposite direction, eroding rights and protections and undermining progressive industrial relations. And perhaps the greatest immediate threat to our hard-won employment rights is the retained EU Law Act, which allows the UK government to rewrite the employment protections we have gained as members of the European Union. Yep.
Katie Clark.
Thank you, and I thank the Minister for taking an intervention. And when I spoke, I referred to the requirement that's been made for all organisations seeking public sector grants to pay the living wage, and I strongly support that the Scottish Government took that step. Are they looking at what further measures can be used through procurement and the award of grants to ensure that other ethical practices are adhered to, including trade union membership?
Minister.
We're always looking to advance the Fair Work agenda, and that's why we work closely with the Fair Work Convention and others in this chamber to ensure we can identify next steps to help workers in this country. I could list a lot of the issues that we think are at risk from the retained EU Law Act at Westminster. We've had many benefits through the European Union, from the maximum working week, the right to rest breaks, to paid annual leave, to protection during pregnancy and for new parents, and protections for agency, fixed-term and part-time workers, and so on and so on. But the uncertainty from Westminster is open-ended for workers and indeed employers as well. And as well as putting rights and protections at risk, the UK government is set on undermining trade unions themselves with the Trade Union Act of 2016, which was the first step. And again, members have mentioned the conduct of employment agencies and employment businesses amendment regulations in 2022, which made it permissible for employment agencies to supply temporary workers to employers facing industrial action, and of course the infamous Strikes Minimum Services Level Act, under which regulations will set levels of service be maintained during strikes and is directly aimed at taking the teeth out of industrial action and circumventing dialogue. And, Presiding Officer, we all hopefully believe that strike busting is no substitute for partnership and negotiation with workers and their representatives. So, given what we have seen, with full control over employment law, the Scottish Government could make better, far better choices in terms of the labour market. And that's why the SDUC and the TUC and this Government and many people in Scotland believe in a devolution of employment law to the Scottish Parliament. Final intervention of a few
briefly, time. Mr. Mark.
I thank the Minister for giving way. As a Minister of the Government, I know that he would want to ensure that the SDUC was quoted fully. So does he recognise the words of Ros Foyer, who has said, a guaranteed minimum floor of workers' rights across the UK is a prudent first step? Does he recognise those words?
Minister.
I welcome the support from the TUC, SDUC and the people of Scotland, the devolution of employment law to this Parliament. What I think many people listening to Labour benches today will be is confused. Because on the one hand, the Labour spokespeople have been saying that the election of a UK government will solve everything, echoing the spokespeople for the UK Labour Party who say that we won't need devolution because it will all be sorted out at UK level. But on the other hand, Labour today is arguing that we need devolution for Scotland. You can't have it both ways. We need to know this is a priority for any incoming Labour government, and it's your policy
Mr.
till
Johnson,
today.
I don't think
in conclusion,
the Minister has time
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government, of course, in a stronger economy with independence, which was published in October last year, proposed some specific measures like establishing a fair national minimum wage, stronger access to flexible working, tackling precarious work, legislating to ban fire and rehire, and so on. But the big prize also is better partnership working and stronger institutions. So there's many, many benefits. And I agree with Ivan McKee and others who say that we should not go at the UK's pace. We should set the pace and we should get on with it and get the powers devolved to this Parliament as soon as possible. And we urge the Labour Party to give that commitment to the people of Scotland, stop prevaricating and stick to their promise to devolve employment law to the Scottish Parliament.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate and I close this meeting.